Valentine is an easy difficulty web challenge from the HXP 2022 CTF, where we can create an awesome template for our Valentine and share it with the world. The site provides us the archive containing the application source code, as well as a Docker compose file to reproduce the environment locally. And it provides us also two IPs hosting the actual challenge, that however are no longer working since the CTF has finished. Because we have a ready-to-go Docker compose file, we can start building the environment while taking a deeper look at the files contained inside the archive. Taking a look at the Docker file, we can immediately notice that the application is using Node.js, it is exposing port 3000, and that the flag.txt file is located inside the root folder alongside the read flag binary, which probably must be used to obtain the flag. The Docker compose YAML does not provide us with much information. It simply binds the port 9086 to the port 3000. On the other hand, the package.json file is very interesting. It tells us that the application entry point is the app.js file, but even more interesting, it shows us that the application is using Express and EJS, a simple templating language that lets you generate HTML markup with plain JavaScript. The index.html and app.js file are the core of the application, but we will inspect them later after having taken an active look at the actual challenge. Perfect. At this point, the Docker environment should be ready. We can browse localhost on port 9086 and give a closer look at the application. The index page generates a basic HTML template that we can customize. At the bottom of the page, we can insert a name that will be inserted inside the template instead of the name placeholder. Proxying the traffic through Barb Suite, we can see that template's code is passed to the server inside the TMPL field alongside the specified name. Then the name placeholder is replaced with the user-provided input, and then the resulting output is shown on screen. All the evidence points in the direction of a server-side template injection vulnerability, but if we try to inject some math or some basic payloads, they are not evaluated but instead are reflected as they are. We can try to add other placeholders having different names, but they all get rejected by the backend. If we want to add some other payload different from the original placeholder, we have to find a bypass to the security checks implemented by the application. To do that, we must give a closer look at the application source code, and luckily for us, we have everything we need. As I said before, the app.js file is the application's core. Scrolling through the source code, we can notice that the challenge uses EJS to manage views, and that those views are stored inside the views folder with a random UUID as the file name. The content of those views, which are nothing more than template files, is copied from the TMPL body field. But before writing it inside the view file, the server checks for any placeholder different from the default one. If it finds a different value, it prints out the error message we saw before. Otherwise, it writes TMPL inside the new view and then redirects us to that file. When we request a template file, the function verifies if the card has a valid code and exists. And if there were no problems, it renders the template using the data passed through the query string. Okay, so where is the bug? To investigate the issue with a better perspective, I added inside the source code some debug print statement that show us the state of user-supplied input before any key function. Then I rebuilt the Docker image and started playing around with the parameters we can use. Our first effort was trying to bypass the security controls imposed by the server and be able to write arbitrary data inside a template. One of my teammates noticed that by inserting twice the TMPL field inside the HTTP body, it was possible to pass to the server an array instead of a string, completely bypassing the security checks performed using the substring method. Substring is part of the string prototype and can be used only on string variables. In our case, however, we can pass to the method an array, forcing the if condition to result always false. Unfortunately, we were unable to proceed further because we required an instance of buffer, typed array or data view instead of an array. So we moved further looking for some other bugs. Using the same logic, I tried passing to the template some non-string parameters, noticing that we weren't limited to use only string values, but we were also able to pass arrays or objects to the server. With that in mind, we start looking at the EJS documentation and older vulnerabilities, searching for clues to proceed further. The official EJS documentation pointed us to some very interesting options and features. Among them, the one that made our curiosity clicks was the support for custom delimiters. Among the various options supported by EJS, some of them allow overwriting the characters used by the template as the delimiters. If we manage to pass those values to the rendered method, we can set a completely different placeholder that will pass all the security checks, remaining, however, a valid template variable. The EJS render methods accepts those options as a third parameter, but the render method used by the application is the one defined inside Express, which accepts a locals object as a second argument and which later calls the EJS render file method. Keeping in mind that the challenge passes a full user controllable variable to the render method, and that we already discovered that we can also pass objects instead of string to the server, this path seems promising. The final clue arrives from different articles related to some older EJS vulnerability, which we will inspect shortly, but not before you subscribe to my channel and leave me an undocumented like. Seriously, it would be appreciated so much, so thanks in advance. This next article from 2016 shows that options and data can be passed together using the same object. This feature is also confirmed inside the official EJS documentation, but it will not work anymore for unsafe options like the one showed by Sneak. We can try passing some options as separate field or even as object properties, but it doesn't produce any result. This other article from the GitHub Security Lab completely caught my attention. It talks about an RCE vulnerability in EJS, and the vulnerable code used as a sample has the same features of our challenge. The POC provided is also very similar to the one we are creating, but it was created for EJS 3.15, while the version we are using is the 3.18. If we try the POC against our server, it doesn't work, but it's still a great indicator that we are close to the solution. The final illumination comes from this EJS server-side template injection write-up, which exploited prototype pollution in the library. The article digs down into the EJS source code, showing why the data and the options are merged, but most importantly pointing us to an old undocumented features that we can still use in the later version, the view options. Migrating from Express 2 to 3, the view options mutated into app.locals, but was not removed from the source code. So, by calling the renderFile function and passing a single object containing a setting property containing itself the view options property, we can bypass the opt passable with data filter and overwrite all the properties we want. At this point, we can create a template that uses custom delimiters containing a simple command execution, so that the while loop searching for the single allowed placeholder is bypassed. Then, we can request the template passing the settings point view option fields with the new desired delimiters. Finally, we did it! We have remote command execution and we can exfiltrate the flag either by showing it on the screen or by using OWASP techniques. The intended solution was not so different from the one we adopt, and to be honest, we came across it but didn't get it because of a simple but dangerous error. During the analysis, we didn't consider that the server was configured to run in production mode and that Express, therefore, had caching enabled. When we sent the custom delimiter in the query string, we didn't get back any valid result because the server had already cached the view with the unmodified delimiter since the first time we requested the template. If we try passing the delimiter field the first time we access the template, we obtain the same result achieved using the view option element. Yeah, we overcomplicated the challenge, but it was a nice journey. This was our solution for Valentine. Did you adopt our own approach for other CTFs or real-life application? Let me know it in the comment section below. Thanks to everyone who stayed with me up to here. I hope you enjoyed the video and that you find it helpful. If so, please consider leaving me a like and subscribe to the channel so that we can meet again in the coming videos. Having said that, see you next time. Ciao.